So you think you know where you are? You don't have a freaking clue. A lot of legends touch this turf. All-Americans, Hall of Famers, national champions. I gave my all here. They gave their all right here on this field. See, this place isn't just a football stadium. It's the Roman Coliseum of college football. It'll wrap you up, it'll consume your body and your soul. You can't think, you can't speak. Man, forget trying to hear. This place is unlike anything you've seen before. So tick tock, boys and girls. The countdown to kickoff starts now.
There's Pendridge Holloway.
He's in there. Go for the bomb. Malone's got it. All by himself.
Is there a flag on the play? I don't see one. Touchdown, Carter!
Neyland Stadium in an uproar.
They blocked it!
You're so the Tennessee fans can care less.
Dylan Speed breaks the tackle on the right sideline.
Well, my goodness.
Welcome to Countdown to Kickoff, presented by UT Alumni and Tennessee Athletics. Happy Big Orange Friday to you, and thank you so much for joining us for our virtual pep rally. I am Jayson Swain, former Tennessee football player, UT alum, and host of the Swain event. This event would not be possible without our sponsors and partners, including Secular Sales, First Horizon, Graphic Creations, Graduate Knoxville, One Riverwalk, Pilot Company, Threads, Coca-Cola, Food City, Farm Bureau Insurance, and UT Medical Center. Let's get started today. Today's highlights include remarks from Chancellor Donde Plowman, interview with VFL Chris Brown, recipe and demonstration from Whimsy Cookie, and behind-the-scenes exclusives, Vol Fan of the Week, and so much more. So let's get this thing going. Let's get it going on a Friday, Big On Friday here. To get us started today, let's welcome remarks from the University of Tennessee's ninth Chancellor, Donde Plowman. Chancellor Plowman, welcome to the show.
Hi, Vol Nation. It's Donde Plowman, Chancellor here at UT. I'm so excited for this weekend, this football game, a good rivalry with Missouri, the Missouri Tigers. You know, we're lucky to be called the Volunteers. As you know, being a volunteer has always meant something special. Volunteers have always showed courage in small moments and big forever. And I'm proud to be the leader of this institution and all these volunteers. Now, for this weekend, let's go bring home a victory and go Vols.
I like it. I like it, Chancellor Plowman. I think that's a great idea. The 2-2 Vols face the 2-2 Tigers for a middle of the SEC clash in Columbia this weekend. Tennessee has not been short on big moments in recent weeks. So let's take a look back at the beginning of the Tennessee season and focus on Missouri.
It's a game of one-week seasons. It's a game of one-week seasons. And it takes everybody. It takes 120 guys chasing it every single day.
About us, compete your butt off, one play at a time. All right, go show Vol Nation who we are and what we're about, individually, collectively, as a team. Everybody got it?
Here come the Volunteers. Simmons came right through that gap. Taking a couple of shots in the end zone. This one's hauled in. They're going to run it and nowhere to go. Inside the 10. Touchdown, Tennessee. Backside pressure. Evans, and he dives into the end zone. Pass intercepted by Pace. They get another six.
Love the offensive firepower, and it looks like we're going to get that type of game this weekend against Missouri. Before we jump into the keys of the game, I want to bring on VFL Chris Brown. He's joining us today. Chris, welcome to the program. How are you doing?
Jayson, doing good. How are you?
I'm fired up, man. I'm fired up, ready to go, ready for this matchup for Tennessee.
I think this is going to be a big game for us. You know, coming off of a tough game last week where we had opportunities to come in and do some things. I think we kind of see how we bounce back, and we kind of see what the team is about after kind of going through some adversity. And I know Coach Hype will be fired up, obviously, playing against a team that he used to coach at. So really fired up about it. It's an early game, so people are going to have to get up and get going. As you know, Jayson, that's tough to do, to be on the road and have to get up early and get going. But at the end of the day, I think this is one that we got to try to figure out what to do and how to win this game.
The tight end love, this offense has featured the tight ends in a huge way with Jacob Warren, Princeton Fant. They are making plays and really playing well this season. You know, as a former tight end, what do you think about the tight end so far in this offense?
Yeah, so talking to Jacob Warren, his dad actually works with me. And just so I've had a little relationship with him over the past few years, and to see how much he's evolved. I mean, obviously he's right here, you know, from right here in Knoxville, and caught a lot of balls out there at Farragut. But as you know, Swain, back when we played it, it's a game changer when you have a tight end that can stretch the field. And these boys are way bigger than I ever was. I mean, they're 6'7", and they're good. And obviously Princeton's a little bit smaller than that, but they're stretching the field. I think Coach Heupel does a very good job of getting them involved. And at the end of the day, when you got a 6'7" person like Jacob Warren, who has a wide frame, wide body, it's literally, man, throw up the ball and just go up and get it. And I think you're seeing him make those plays, and I think you'll see Princeton make those plays too, given the opportunity.
Playing tight end position, I mean, you kind of have to be an Army Swiss knife, right? You got to be able to do so many different things.
Yeah, when Coach Cutcliffe got here, you know, your senior year, my junior year, that was something that he really implemented, was being more of an H-back, kind of being a jack of all trades. You have to know every play. You have to know what the offensive line is doing. You have to know what the receivers are doing. You got to check with the quarterback. Sometimes you're in the backfield. So you know, that's something that's important in the sense of you always get to stay on the field as well, right? So no matter what package is coming in, it's something that you have to do. And it's tough for a guy like Jacob. I know for a guy like myself as well. It's like, man, I don't want to go in there and block a big defensive end or have to go in there and ISO a linebacker or do something like that. But you figure it out. And then when you start getting the ball more and you see consistently that blocking is going to also help you catch passes, it's going to help with the play action, it's going to get you open. And everything kind of just starts sinking to where you're on the field the majority of the time and you're having 6-7 game catches with touchdowns and all that stuff. And now you become a weapon that people are having a game plan for.
It's a nice trade-off. You block a little bit, catch a couple balls, makes you want to block a little bit more.
You can – and just a little bit. I mean, it don't make you want to block a lot. But, again, I think the blocking part's important because you learn different techniques to block, right, Swain? You learn how to cut somebody. You learn – just because it's an ISO, you don't have to go in there and just necessarily headbang. I just got to get in your way enough to where you can't get off and make the tackle. And once you get some experience in learning that – I mean, I wasn't the biggest guy, but I think you figure out – techniques, you figure out different stuff that you can do, and then when they throw you the rock, that just makes you want it more. When you catch a 40-50 yard pass, man, you know that there's plays in the end zone or plays once you get closer to the goal line that they're throwing the ball to the tight end. I mean, we practice them all the time, and I think that's where it's going, and I think this game this week will be very exciting with it.
Chris, let's talk about this Mizzou game. You know, you mentioned it a little earlier that it is a noon kickoff for us watching it, but local time, it'll be 11 o'clock. And so I like away games because you can go on the road and, you know, you see all the fans, you know, talking trash at you, and you get a chance to kind of quiet them by a good performance and coming away with the win. What do you think it's going to take for Tennessee to be able to do that on the road, Missouri, this 11 local time kickoff? How do we win, man?
Yeah, you know, like you talked about, I think when you go on the road, it's fun. I mean, when you pull up to the stadium and you do your walkthrough on Friday, You kind of go to the hotel and you got some people there and you start getting that vibe, right? And it's fun to go out there and score early. It's fun to go out there. And these games are fun as well because you can go out there and play and you get to get back to Knoxville fairly quickly. Now, I think we have to figure out a way to run the ball consistently. And I think just third downs, I mean, Swain, you know, when you have an opportunity to kind of keep the ball away from another team and you have a play that you have to make, you just can't miss those opportunities. You just can't. So I truly think that stuff's going to come. I mean, you get kicked down, you have stuff that happens. You just have to figure out a way to fight the adversity and do it. Defensively, I think our defense is flying around. And I think when you play fast, good stuff happens. Missouri, I think, is not the team that they once were. But I also think Missouri can come out and play. And, you know, for whatever reason, no matter our record, no matter what happens, we always get the best from every single team. So, you know, they'll show up to play. 11 o'clock is very early. I guess they'll just have to eat the spaghetti and the steaks and eggs and all that with a pregame meal. Like, you know, it's not going to change.
For sure. You know, Chris, big game between the two teams. Both teams are 2-2. And honestly, every game is a must win. But for Tennessee and Missouri, I mean, we're talking about being able to go up 3-2 and put yourself in position to potentially go to a bowl game. So as a player, how do you make sure that you don't put too much pressure on yourself? Because you know the coaches understand how important this one is because we let Pittsburgh slip away. So how do you make sure you just treat this game like every other game and not put too much pressure on yourself?
Yeah, I think you lean on experience. I mean, you lean on guys that have been there. And at the end of the day, I think, you know, over the last 3, 4, 5 years, however you want to call it, we haven't won a lot of football games, but there's a lot of guys that are still there that have been there. And at the end of the day, it's still football. It's still blocking. It's still catching. It's still throwing the ball. And I think once you get out there, once you make a play, once you see some good stuff happening, you just control your emotions. I mean, that's the biggest thing is, yes, I think the coaches know that it's pretty much a must win for both of these teams. Missouri must win it. We must win it to kind of get us to where we are. And to be 3-2 after 5 games, I think anybody would take it to know that we let the Pittsburgh game just straight up slip away. I mean, that should have been a W. So you learn from that Pittsburgh game. You learn from the Florida game from the past week. Obviously, you learn from the 2 games that you won. And you just go in there and you show up because you know Missouri is going to come to play regardless. They will be ready to play ball. And at the end of the day, I think we should – if you put it on paper, we should beat them. But you know how the SEC goes, man. It's tough. It's tough to go on the road and win. I don't care who it is.
For sure, for sure. Well, Chris, man, it's always a pleasure to talk to you. I will say on the way out, that's a nice orange shirt you got there. I like the way you have a button to the top.
Hey, you know, trying to you called me handsome earlier. You got me all excited. So when you did that, I, you know,
you're handsome.
But you look, you look good too, though. Hey, I like your button to the top too.
Thank you. Well, Chris, man, thanks so much for the time. Let's go beat those Tigers this weekend.
Yes, sir. Good to see you, Jayson. Thank you.
Now it's time to get to the keys to the game. The first kick is set for noon tomorrow against Missouri, and with the early start. For the road trip, these are the three keys to the Vols leaving Columbia with the victory. Number one is run with purpose. Tennessee needs to run the football successfully. Last week did a really good job of running the football at times against Florida, a defense that's better than Mizzou. Need to run the football with purpose. Missouri is 129th in the country nationally out of 130 teams. So they are not great at stopping the run. And they are last in the SEC. Tennessee needs to take advantage of that, run the football. Jabari Small, Tyon Evans, throw in Hendon Hooker there in the running game. I want to see Tennessee run the football and really control the game. Need to do that very, very well. Number two, affect the passer. Now, Missouri leads the SEC, and they're 7th nationally on third down conversion. So they do a really good job of extending drives. They are a passing football team. They do a good job of getting the ball out of the quarterback's hands, quick, fast, and in a hurry. They don't give up sacks. One of the best teams in the country at making sure they protect their quarterback. Last week against Boston College, they did not give up a sack at all. So affect the passer. Yes, you want to get sacks. You want to hit them, but hurry him. get your hands up when you throw in the football. Bat down balls, tip balls can result in interceptions and turnovers going the other way for Tennessee, but affect the passer. And there's multiple ways to do that, not just sacks. Tip passes, hurries, maybe get him off his spot a little bit. Don't allow him to be comfortable in the pocket. And then number three is limit penalties. I mean, we mentioned earlier, Chris and I, during a conversation, that let the Pittsburgh game slip away because of penalties. And, you know, you got to not beat yourselves if you want to beat the opponent. And Tennessee's a good enough football team to beat Missouri if we take care of the penalties. So no pre-snap penalties. Limit those as best as you can. Understand that you got to play disciplined football. Don't let the emotions get the best of you and make a play that hurts your football team. So you want to limit those penalties. Ideally, you want zero, but that's hard to do. But you certainly want to limit those and not have a situation where you have 100 more penalty yards. So let's recap. Let's go over it again, folks. Number one, run with a purpose. Run with the purpose. Run the football. Be successful in that area. And number two, affect the passer. Get after Connor Baselike. They do a good job protecting him, but there's other ways to affect him. So certainly want to do that. And then number three, limit the penalties. Don't beat yourself. Play smart. Play fast. Have fun. But make sure that we limit those penalties. Very, very, very important. So let's move on. Let's do it. Have a good time this afternoon. So let's keep it going. Tennesseans are one of a kind, and it means something very, very special to be a Vol. Embedded with core values of kindness, care, and loyalty, let's take a small glimpse at just what it means to be a Vol.
Well, I think Tennessee is just a loyal state. If you're a Tennessee resident and you're loyal to your state, you're not going to be an Alabama fan. You're going to be a Tennessee fan.
Starting route to Knoxville.
I'm a Tennessee fan because I believe in being true to my school, so to speak, and my state.
Football is back in Big Orange country.
That's one of the things that drew me to Tennessee many, many years ago was the friendliness and the ability to everyone to invite you in their homes and to help you if you're having car troubles or anything. We volunteer to help people all the time because we're just that friendly. We're a friendly state. And that makes me proud of being a Tennessean.
And what a setting it is. The fans are back. Beautiful night to play football.
I think people are true to their state and not just their school, but, you know, we're proud to be Tennesseans and proud to be a fan.
As we just saw, it means something special to be a volunteer. And what better way to show your volunteer pride by taking it with you everywhere you go? You can do this and take your volunteer spirit on the road with the new official license plate for Tennessee alumni. The purchase of each plate supports student scholarships and enables success of volunteers today and tomorrow. You can learn more about these plates at alumni.utk.edu/license plate. Orange and white just looks perfect on the ride when you're driving down 140. Just perfect. So make sure you get a Tennessee license plate. It's week two for our alumni recipe of the week. And this week, we are so excited to touch your sweet tooth. So we do that with Whimsy Cookie, located in Bearden and managed by Kara Summers.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Whimsy Cookie Company. I'm Carrie Summers, and I'm the manager and owner here at the store. And this is Ruth White, and she's one of our talented decorators. Today, we're going to be taking you through the process of how to make some royal icing, outline, and base ice these cookies. And then we can show you the product at the end. She is going to start by taking 2 pounds of powdered sugar, which is just one of our bags. And then we take 3 tablespoons of meringue powder, which we've already measured out there. Then we're gonna take 3 tablespoons of vanilla, and that's clear vanilla, and 5 tablespoons of water. So you're gonna mix all of that together before we add our coloring in.
At this point, the icing is at a good consistency for piping. It's not very stiff, but it's not overly liquidy. So I'll go ahead and add the food coloring now. And once we have the amount of piping that we need, we add more water, and we make it a flood consistency.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we have our icing. We've put it in our 12-inch piping bags. We put number 4 tips on everything to outline here. And she's gonna start with the power tee, so she's gonna start with the orange icing, and she's just gonna trace those edges with the tip of her icing. So now she's gonna take the white to the helmet, and once again, just tracing the edges. Just stay right on the edge of your cookie. And lastly, the football. So she's gonna take the brown in the same size piping bag and icing tip and do the exact same thing. Now, in these bottles, that is what we thinned our icing out to be more like flood. So it's the thinner consistency, more kind of like water. So it's easier to fill the middle of your outline. So she's gonna take her 2-in-1 decorating tool and move that icing around. So she's gonna start with the football, and we just do the sides of the football and the laces at the top as well. And then we add our little balls flare to them. All right, and so now you're ready for your tailgates for all the big games with your Vols cookies. Thank you all so much for watching this demonstration with us. We are so happy to have you in our Whimsy home here in Knoxville. Be sure to come see us for all your tailgating needs and all your officially licensed Vols cookies.
Cookies at 11 a.m. Central Time and noon? Absolutely. Sign me up. We'll be bouncing off the walls. Tennessee's putting up points against Missouri this weekend. Isn't that right, Dwayne?
Yes, sir. Let me tell you, I want one of those power tea cookies right now, Jay.
That's right. It's good to see you. Happy Big Orange Friday to you. Dwayne Wiles is our Associate Chancellor for Alumni Affairs. Happy Big Orange Friday, Dwayne.
Happy Big Orange Friday. And it's certainly good to be with you for another week, Jay, on Countdown to Kickoff. And hello, Vol Nation. Before the game against Mizzou tomorrow, let me share with our viewing audience how you can be proud, be involved, and be invested in UT. Number one, be proud by showing your big orange spirit and wearing orange each and every Friday. And as you heard Jay mention earlier in the show, another way in which you can show your volunteer spirit year-round is by purchasing that brand new UT license plate. Number two, be involved by using our lifelong resources, taking advantage of all of the leadership opportunities that we offer throughout the year, and attending our in-person and virtual events like this one today. You can learn more by going online at alumni.utk.edu. And number three, be invested in our students. Please help us continue to support students by giving at least one gift, any size, every year. And you can donate by simply texting VOLS to 865-345-5100. Ladies and gentlemen, it's that simple. Just text VOLS to 865-345-5100. Jay, it's always a pleasure spending some time with you. Again, I can't wait for the game tomorrow, and go Big Orange.
That is right. Thank you so much, Dwayne, Associate Vice Chancellor for Alumni Affairs, Dwayne Wild, joining us this afternoon. So appreciate you so much, Dwayne, for your commitment. And before we end today, a big congratulations to Stacy Dixon. She is our Vol Fan of the Week. Do you want to win next week? And if you do, all you have to do is follow Tennessee Alumni on Facebook, Twitter, or on Instagram for details on how to win. And mark your calendars. Please mark your calendars for our next show, Countdown to Kickoff event, which will be October the 22nd. So we've got some time now. But that takes place before the third Saturday in October when the Vols travel down to play Alabama in Tuscaloosa. Join us then at 12:30 p.m. Eastern right here. And don't forget to tune in tomorrow to Tennessee when they take on Missouri at 12 p.m. on the SEC Network. Hope you have a great weekend. Go Big Orange and beat the Tigers.